Good morning, everybody. Would you all please stand with me? And I'll open us up in some prayer before worship. God, I thank you for another day that we just get to be here and worship you, God. May you help us to truly engage in that this morning. I know a lot of times I can speak for myself, you know, even as I'm reading my Bible or trying to focus on you, there's other distractors going on in my mind. There's a test that I have to take at, 12 o'clock, or the homework that's due at midnight, or whatever it may be. But all of these things that, you know, are going through my mind are taking me off from what I could be having with you. So in these 15 minutes that we get to have with you here at chapel this morning, would you help us to just truly dedicate them to you and just take off all distractions off of our mind, no matter how stressed we are, no matter, you know, how much work we have to get done. May we just truly be here 100% with you, God. And may you just give us a heart of worship this morning. In Jesus' name. I need you. Soften my heart, break me apart. I need you to open my eyes to see that you're shaping my life. And all I am, I surrender. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you to soften my heart, to break me apart. Trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. So I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. So I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. Sing, I may be weak. 'Cause I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. God, I thank you that you will never be weak, that you will always be strong for us. That we can just really, truly just rely on you. Thank you. set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. And I could sing of your love forever, and I could sing of your love forever. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock, and now I know that I love you and I need you. And though my world may fall, I will never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, and I will worship you until the very end. Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. Set my feet upon the rock, and now I know I love you and I need you. I want you more of my fall. I will never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, and I will worship you until the very end. lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock, and now I know that I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, yeah, I will worship you until the very end.
See?
Lord, I love the line where it says, when we arrive at eternity's shore, where death is just a memory and tears are no more, there will one day be a place where those who follow you will come back to you, and there will be no more tears. There will be no more pain. There will be no more suffering. There will be no more homeless. There will be no more sin. There will just be you and us and the heavenly kingdom that you have prepared for us. God, thank you so much for preparing a home for us. Thank you for loving us. Seated.
Well, good morning, and thank you to Chris and Sarah for leading us this morning in worship. Before I welcome our chapel speaker this morning, we want to recognize a significant milestone. During this upcoming recess, our very own Dr. Fred Belke, Professor Emeritus of History, will turn 90 years old. Congratulations to Dr. Belke. We have some things for you, Fred. Fred, if you come forward here. You know, Fred, when you were born, Calvin Coolidge was the president, just to put things in perspective. So we're grateful that you're here. In this academic year, we have asked the question, what is the gospel? And we've asked for speakers to consider that topic. We've also talked about it in classes and so forth. And this morning's speaker, to me, offers a very embodied understanding of the gospel. The active conforming of one's life to the arc or shape of the gospel. And he does so with great humility. He's an inspiring example of what it means to live into the gospel in the small and larger issues one faces in life. And he is also a proud graduate of Eastern University. And we're grateful that he's here this morning. In preparation for this brief introduction, we actually combed the student yearbook. Well, we did. I spend most of my time just combing through things. Shane Claiborne went to school here in the 90s, and he was quite involved with two ministries, at least in my recollection, the Clown Connection, which we actually had a clowning ministry at one time, and Transform. Both of those, I think, shaped you for ministry in many regards here. I have just a photo of Shane there. And another photo here as he's working through something. I'm not sure what's that hanging from his chin, but we're still trying to figure that out. Also, too, Shane was part of Transformed, and this must have been some type of Lenten kind of play or something, because right in the background there is Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. So I'm not sure the motif there. And then last but not least, we have Shane, I think doing kind of a Shakespearean soliloquy during that time of Lent there. But we are delighted that he's here, and I'm glad you're here to hear him this morning. We have books and materials for purchase in the lobby if you'd like. Please check out that table. And also, Shane's going to be here for lunch and have an extended conversation. So if you'd like to join us at 11:30, please do. And as a matter of fact, Sodexo was so gracious enough to give a discounted lunch price for those who don't have a meal plan. It's only $5 today, so come. Grab something to eat and join us in the Baird Library. That's in Walton Hall, right in the Student Center at 11:30 we'll gather. So we're excited today. Would you please give a warm round of applause for Shane Claiborne.
Wow, it's great to be here. And I'll have to say, Joe, my rather solemn message of hellfire and damnation has been undermined by, subverted by these clown pictures. I'm excited to be with you and to think together about this idea of what is the gospel, because I think we talk a lot about the whole gospel for the whole world, but sometimes we may not always know the depth of the words we use. And there's a little project we did called Jesus for President, and I learned a ton as we were doing this project, because one of the things I didn't know was that, like, 10 years before Jesus, like, it was around 6 BC, this was found inscribed in Asia Minor. It says this: "The most divine Caesar, we should consider equal to the beginning of all things. For when everything was falling into disorder and tending toward dissolution, he restored it once more and gave the whole world a new aura. Caesar, the common good fortune of all, the beginning of life and vitality, all the cities unanimously adopt the birthday of the divine Caesar as the beginning of the year." The calendars revolved around it. "Whereas the providence which has regulated our whole existence has brought our life to the climax of perfection in giving us the Emperor Augustus, who being sent to us and our descendants as Savior of the world, has put an end to war, has set all things in order, and whereas having become God manifest, Caesar has fulfilled all the hopes of earlier times, the birthday of the God Augustus has become for the world the beginning of the gospel." So there was another Savior, right? There was another gospel. And as the almost everything in Jesus's life begins to take shape, we see this almost like satire and subversion of the predominant power and gospel of the age. And all the words that we've become so familiar with, gospel, faith, kingdom, throne, these were all like ripped right out of the imperial lexicon. Like, these were words people knew, right? And so it is very clear that, you know, 2,000 years ago, saying Caesar is Lord or Jesus is Lord would be just as radical as saying Jesus is our commander in chief. Hence our book, Jesus for President. Read it. No, but you know, but that idea, like, was that these Christians, these peculiar folks, were proclaiming a different gospel, and they were proclaiming a different allegiance. Their identity was not revolving around Caesar, but around this man Jesus. And so that we see in Acts, these men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here. They are defying Caesar's decrees, and they are saying there is another king. One called Jesus. So that's pretty beautiful, right? And I think, like, what does that mean for us, you know, as we think about, in case you haven't noticed, it's election year. And I mean, there's all kinds of crazy misplaced hope, right? Folks that are promising all sorts of things. And yet, like, I think for us, the greatest danger for us in an election year is to misplace our hope and think this person or this party is going to actually be God manifest, or this is going to change the world and end all wars. And so as we think about the early Christians, I take a lot of courage from them because they had this peculiar relationship, this distinctive identity in Christ. And every time they were praying, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," that was the exact same language. The word kingdom was empire, right? So let your empire, let your reign come. What would it look like if God was our president, our governor, what if God's dream was lived out on my block in our country? And this is what they were dreaming of. So when they said, like, our citizenship is in heaven, there was a strange thing. And it was very unpopular. That's why, like, as I think of the early Christians, like, they were accused of everything. You know, you read about it. They were accused of being atheists because they had actually lost all faith in Caesar. And in so many of the things that people put their faith and trust in. And I think it's important for us to remember that vote shares the same root as devotion, right? It's about what we hope in, what we admire, what we adore. And so as we think of what's truly beautiful and where our hope truly lies, these Christians are a great inspiration because they were accused of being irreligious folks. They were accused of being cannibals, right? Because we had this strange tradition of, like, eating and drinking blood, right? But people were all trying to figure out who they were. And one of my favorite accusations was incest, because some of the critics of Christianity said, "Oh, these Christians, they just, like, call each other brother and sister indiscriminately," right? And then Tertullian said, "Well, we share everything in common except our spouses." So kind of corrected them, you know. But listen to this accusation. These are the words actually of Tertullian. He said, "We are charged with being irreligious people. And what is more, we are charged in being irreligious in respect to the emperors, since we refuse to pay homage to their imperial majesties. It is high treason against the Roman religion. It is crime against, it is a crime of open irreligion, a raising of the hand to injure the deity of Rome. For Christians are considered to be enemies of the state. We do not celebrate the festivals of the Caesars. Guards and informers bring up all kinds of accusations against the Christians that we are traitors, we are blasphemers, we are charged with sacrilege, we are charged with high treason. But we give testimony to the truth." Amen. Can I get a witness? That was pretty something special. And I think of what does that mean for us? You know, because there's all kinds of empty promises. And I remember hearing these words first of President Bush some time ago. He said, "There's power, wonder-working power, and the goodness and idealism and faith of the American people." There's like a song that's almost like that. You know, there is power, but it's not the American people. But there's the ideal of America is the hope of all mankind. The hope still lights our way, and light shines in darkness. The darkness will not overcome it. There's a verse that's almost like that, but it's not America, it's Jesus, right? So I think that's like the peculiarness. And to be very fair, Barack Obama on the David Letterman show in 2007, he said, "This country is still the last best hope on earth." So as we think of that, I think we have a suspicion about those kind of things, right? We go, no, we found the last best hope on earth. We found the light of the world, and it's not America. It's actually not Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders. It's actually Jesus, and that's where our identity lies. And our Bible doesn't say God so loved America, but God so loved the world. And when that frames our imagination, right, where we begin to think like that, I think it affects everything. So then these things like immigration are not just political issues. It's about what it means to love my neighbor as myself, right? What does it mean to have neighbors that are struggling and trying to escape all kinds of troubles? And what does it mean to love my neighbor as myself and be born again so that it's just as troubling if someone else's child is dying as if it was my own, right? That our love isn't confined to borders. Our love is boundless. And as we think of that, I think part of what we have to have is imagination. And because there's this invitation to kind of come out of our identity in this world. And as Tony likes to say, you know, we may live in the best Babylon in the world, but it's still Babylon, right? We're still called to be set apart. And as we look at that word, you know, of holy, of God's people, we are to be set apart from the nations. We're to be a little different. I like how my friend Stanley Hauerwas says, he goes, well, Christians in the world, we're supposed to be a little like air fresheners in a bathroom. You know, that we're meant to leave off the fragrance of Jesus, that we're to be light in the darkness. And when I think of what that actually looks like, because I think sometimes our challenge is not articulating it, but embodying it, right? Because there's a lot of folks who have great words, but our challenge, I think, is that in the gospel, what happens is words become flesh, right? That we don't just have words on paper, but we have the word become flesh in Jesus. As Bruxy Cavey says, I believe in the inerrant, infallible word of God. His name is Jesus, right? And so we look to Jesus, and now we're invited to be that gospel, to join that love, that we might say, the life I live, I no longer live, but Jesus lives in me. So as we think of what that really looks like, I like the Amish for a lot of reasons. I'm not trying to convince everybody to be Amish, but I think when it comes to being set apart and being a distinctive people in the world, right, that they've got something. They're going to survive whatever happens on Wall Street. You know, they still know how to make clothes and grow food. And I was speaking in Indiana, and when I speak, one of my friends encouraged me to try to offset the carbon footprint of my travel, which, like, I've done that a lot of different ways. This morning, Megan picked me up, and we shared a car, but everywhere I go, I try to do that. When I was in Indiana, it was interesting, because I was in Amish country, and they're like, oh, cool, we'll have the Amish pick you up. I was like, awesome. And they're like, you'll know us at the airport. We're the ones with the horse, you know? And we get in to the buggy, my buddy Chris and I, and we're driving, and he kept telling bad jokes, you know, Chris. Like, Chris was like, he kept telling him, like, can you turn up the radio? The Amish, you know. So anyway, we're there, we're driving along, but we're like listening to the horse hooves, you know, and we're driving. It was 30 miles, so it took a while. I mean, a couple hours, you know. We're watching all the billboards and the neon signs and the Walmart pass by, and incidentally, the Walmart had a hitching post, which created a number of dilemmas in me that they, you know, the Amish could shop there. But anyway, we kept going, and we get on to the event. But as they're telling about their life, it was so interesting to understand, to listen to how they understood who they are to be in the world. You know, and you can hear their kids going, Dad, why don't we have cars? Horses are so 1800s, dude. You know, and them being told, well, we're different. You know, and actually there's all kinds of problems with the cars and the pace that much of our world lives. We have a different story. We revolve around a different message. You know, in light of that, maybe it's not so hard to understand why they responded the way they did after the terrible school shooting. And some of you may remember, this is like 8 years ago or something, just a couple hours from here, a very deranged man went, happened to be the milkman of the community, but he was having a lot of trouble psychologically, and he went in and he killed a bunch of the Amish kids, and then he killed himself. But what caught the world's attention wasn't just the horror of the incident. It was how the Amish responded. They immediately went to the shooter's family, the Roberts family, and they showered them with love. And they said, you must be really upset. Is there anything that we can do for you? And I've gotten to know Terry Roberts, the mother of Charlie, who did the shooting. He was responsible for the killing. And she describes the Amish coming in and just holding her husband as he wept and wiping away his tears. And these are the people that just lost their kids too, right? And then the people began to pour out money to the Amish, and they took the money and they created scholarships for the children of the Roberts family. And as the funerals rolled around, they went to the funeral of their own kids, but then they went to the funeral of Charlie Roberts too, so that they could grieve with their family. And I mean, it was so fascinating to watch it unfold, because the news is not good at nuance, you know? And yet, what made the front page headlines in Australia was not just the horror of the massacre, but the front page in Australia. I was speaking there at the time, and it said, "Amazing Grace. Why would the Amish do what they did?" And since then, there's been a book called Amish Grace. There's been story after story trying to understand the Amish community. And even since then, Terry, the mother of Charlie, one of the things that she began to do to heal from this situation is there was one little girl, Rosanna, who survived the shooting. She was shot, but she wasn't killed, and her whole life is different. She's confined to a wheelchair and things like that. But every week, Terry goes over and visits with her, and sings and reads and bathes her. And she says every week she goes, she's confronted with the horror of what her son was responsible for. But grace gets the last word. That healing, redemption, and you think of that, the scandal of that love, and how the Amish responded. And that's why we got a little section of our book called Amish for Homeland Security. Because you think, what if after September 11th we had had that kind of imagination, right? Well, how might the world look different? And I think part of what's in danger is that as Christians, especially in the United States, where it looks like everything's kind of Christian, then we lose our distinctiveness, right? We lose the flavor, the fragrance that we have. As all of our money says, in God we trust, but Wendell Berry says our economy still looks like the seven deadly sins. You know, that we can brand everything Christian, but where everything is Christian, nothing is Christian, because we lose that distinctiveness. So I think that's where the Amish are really amazing. And Mother Teresa is another great example. Some of you may have heard me tell the story of her feet, but this is Mother Teresa's foot. I know it's a little abrupt, but one of the things that has marked my memory of Mother Teresa as we worked in Calcutta for a summer right after our sophomore year here at Eastern was going to worship every morning. We took off our shoes and I noticed her feet were deformed. But I wasn't about to ask her, you know, what's up with that? You know, like it's Mother Teresa. So, but one of the nuns said, "Have you noticed her feet?" And I said, "Yeah." She said, "Her feet are deformed because we get just enough shoes donated for everybody to get a pair, and she doesn't want someone to have a worse pair than she has. So she digs through the donations, she finds the worst pair, and makes sure that everybody else has good ones." And that idea of loving our neighbor as ourselves, honoring the needs of others above our own, that's different, right? I mean, that's different from the gospel of the Kardashians, right? That's different from the gospel of Donald Trump. There is a different gospel in Jesus than the dominant pattern of the world that we live in. And so as we think of that, I think one of the things that Eastern, that you get to wrestle with as a community, is what makes you distinctive, right? How do we make the gospel speak in our times, for such a time as this? And on the way over there here this morning, I was reading one of the great sermons of Dr. King. Dr. Martin Luther King wrote a powerful sermon entitled Remaining Awake in the Revolution, right? And staying awake in the revolution. He tells the story of Rip Van Winkle, who slept through a revolution, right? And wakes up 20 years later and goes, "Whoa, the world's different now," you know? And I want to be very clear that I think right now we're in the time of change, and I don't want us to miss out. Right? Because right now, every single day in Philadelphia, we have someone getting killed. We have 11,000 folks dying every year of gun violence. So what does that, how can we wake up the world beginning with ourselves, right? How can we make ourselves sensitive to the pain of the world? Because, like, gun violence, no one really wants to debate gun control, you know? Like, I don't know too many people that have been argued into thinking differently, but I'll tell you what changed my life. As a little East Tennessee kid that came up here, like, half my family was in the NRA. Like, I grew up with guns. Like, you know, we got country music. Says, this house is protected by the good Lord and a gun, and if you come unwanted, you'll meet them both, son. Like, that's where I grew up, right? I grew up eating squirrel gravy and frog gigging. Like, I know what, but yet, like, I'm reminded one of the kids that moved into Philly, he said, why do we have so many gun shops in Philly when there aren't that many deer? And I think what I started to see is that the epidemic of gun violence is, I mean, I was actually looking at Guinness Book of World Records with one of the kids, and one of the records, you know, we're flipping through all these weird things, like most piercings and tattoos, you know, and like we flip the page and it says most guns. And it was the U.S. that holds the record with over 300, right at 300 million guns. We've got 90 guns for every 100 people, almost one for one. The second biggest record holder is India, where they have 4 guns for every 100 people, just a little bit of, you know. But that, it's not just the numbers, but it's a 19-year-old named Papito, right, that we heard the gunshots ring out. I ran outside. He fell on my front step. I held his hand, and the next morning he died. And Dr. King said, we're all called to be the Good Samaritan, but after you lift so many people out of the ditch, you start to say maybe the whole road to Jericho needs to be reimagined, right? That we are called to lift people out of the ditch, but we also need to go up the street a little bit and see what's landing people there, right? That, and I think that's one of the issues that grabbed us, because it was names, people, faces. And so we started doing vigils in the streets, and we're going to have one on Good Friday in just a few weeks. This was one of our Good Friday services in front of the gun shop. And I got to tell you, one of the most powerful services I ever had. The young men in our neighborhood, including Derek, who just graduated from Eastern, like the young guys carried the cross, and we carried it in front of the gun shop that's 2 blocks from my house. Not just any gun shop, but this is one of the worst gun shops in the country. Over 200 guns sold there that were tracked to violent crimes on the street. So this is a very irresponsible gun shop. So we had our prayer vigil there. But what was amazing was as we vigiled, we read the narrative of Jesus dying on the cross and the women weeping at the foot of the cross. But then we invited the mothers to tell the story of losing their kids on our streets. And something powerful happened as the gospel connected to our streets, right? And then we heard some good preaching, you know, about how it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And the tomb is empty. In the end, like, death doesn't get the last word. Life does, right? But as we even had a rabbi that said, I don't come to a lot of Good Friday services, but I like this one, you know. And then one of the mothers came up to me afterwards, and she said, I get it. I said, what do you get? And she said, God understands my pain. Because God knows what it feels like to lose a son. And I realized as the tears rolled down her face, that was Papito's mom. It was a mother of that 19-year-old. And that's the power of the gospel. When it doesn't exist in some fantastic esoteric world, but it actually comes down to earth, just as Jesus did, that we are to connect the gospel with our streets and with our world. So dream about that a little bit, right? Think, what could Eastern contribute to that? And I saw like a suburban congregation that ended up, this is actually the one of the guns that we transformed. Some of y'all have seen our gun transformations where we've been beating guns into plows, and there's one out on the table that I'll take to lunch too. But we've been transforming these guns literally with some blacksmiths and metal crafters. But one of the really great things that we've seen is congregations that start to put out t-shirts to lament and grieve the names of those who have died. So I thought, wouldn't it be an amazing thing if, like, on Key Hill or something, we put a 400 t-shirts for the kids that have died this year in Philly or Chester or Norristown, right? That we begin to connect this place with the pain that's just 15 minutes, 30 minutes away from here. And it's around the corner, too, but it's also, like, right here in our city. And I get one of the advantages that I get to see is, like, I get to travel to, you know, maybe 50 schools or something every year. And Eastern's still my favorite, of course. But, like, there's people doing such creative stuff, right? I was down at Warren Wilson College, and the students... created an eco dorm where they put solar panels and they decided that they would hang their laundry out to dry. They even created these washing machines that double as a stationary bike. So as you bike, it does your laundry. Most of you need a little exercise anyway, you know, so like, it was amazing. Like, I think how creative, and they ended up like making the New York Times. It says, you know, this dorm goes green. It's an eco dorm. And I think, like, when we talk about the gospel in the world, the gospel for the world, I dream of Eastern keeping that distinctiveness. And I'll be real honest. I think that if we don't keep that distinctiveness, we're going to begin to fade into the backdrop, right? We've got to stay in touch with the pain of the world. And it's not just going to come from the administration. Like, we know well from Jesus and the early church that change doesn't trickle down, but it bubbles up, right? It begins with folks that begin to say, we're going to do stuff differently. We want to bear witness of God's love. I was down in Berea College in down south somewhere. They now have jobs that they do on campus. So they make baskets and they create metal crafting. And tuition is now free. It is free because they've created all of these businesses that students do in order to fund their campus, right? I think of that. I think that's amazing. So I want us to dream together, right? And some of us, all of you are welcome to come after chapel to lunch and we can keep talking about it. But I want to read these words as we kind of start to close up. And this is as the early Christians were, you know, living 2,000 years ago. Folks were trying to figure out what are these people? Who are these renegade Jews? And there's one of the emperors sent out a historian to sniff around a little bit and come back and tell me who the Christians are. So this is the letter that Aristides in 137 AD wrote back to the emperor describing the early Christians, right? So he's not a Christian. He's a historian, but he says this. It is the Christians, O emperor, who have sought and found the truth, for they acknowledge God. They do not keep for themselves the goods entrusted to them. They do not covet what belongs to others. They show love to their neighbors. They do not do to another what they would not want done to themselves. They speak gently to those who oppress them, and in this way they make them their friends. It has become their passion to do good to their enemies. They live in the awareness of their smallness. Every one of them who has anything gives ungrudgingly to the one who has nothing. If they see a traveling stranger, they bring them into their own home under their own roof. They rejoice over them as if they were a real brother or sister, for they don't call one another brother and sister because of the flesh, but they know that they are brothers in the spirit of God. If they hear that one of them is imprisoned or oppressed for the sake of Christ, they take care of all their needs. If possible, they set them free. And if anyone among them is poor or comes into want while they themselves have nothing to spare, then everyone fasts for 2 or 3 days. In this way, they can supply any poor person with the things they need. This, O emperor, is the rule of life for the Christians, and this is their manner of life. So they didn't just have a gospel that they proclaimed, but they had a gospel that they embodied. People were paying attention, even people that didn't like them. Like, the Emperor Julian sent out this memo that said, those godless Galileans are taking care of our poor and their own. They're doing so much good in the world. They didn't even like them, but they couldn't help but be fascinated by them. So our invitation, there's going to be lots and lots of words from politicians and empty promises. And I think for us to stay focused on Jesus and to say, we want to embody the good news. And we're not going to wait on politicians to change the world. We are going to follow Jesus, and we're going to change the world by the way that we love one another, by the way that we beat swords into plows, by the way that we pledge our allegiance to the Prince of Peace. Amen? Let me pray for us. So God, we pray, thanking you for Jesus, thanking you for the Word made flesh. Give us courage to follow. Give us imagination that we might not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. We are devoted to you. Our vote is every single day for your kingdom. We pray that it would come on earth as it is in heaven. I pray for this community here at Eastern that I love so much. I pray that you would give them creativity, a distinctiveness, a flavor of justice and love, that people would look upon this place and say, what is it about that Eastern community that makes them so different? Why do they love those people? We pray all of this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 You can go in peace, I think, right? Amen. Or come to lunch.